And we're going to be looking at John, the 20th chapter. Brother, can you go get me a paperweight off my desk? I'm desperately going to need it. We're going to be looking at John chapter 20 this morning. If I can keep this Bible from blowing away. I know we're going through some tough times. A lot of folks have been discouraged. A lot of folks have been confused. Just wondering, what's next? Some people have gotten to the point saying, Lord, I don't know if I can take any more of this. But I want to share with you something from the Word of God this morning that just might encourage you. We're going to be talking about the Lord Jesus, of course, but we're also going to be talking about His disciples. You've got to remember that for over 3 years, the disciples were with Jesus. They went everywhere He went. They saw all the miracles that He had performed.
Well, you may need both of them. Let's see, brother. Thank you.
They saw Him heal the sick. They saw Him raise up the crippled. They saw Him give sight to the blind. They saw Jesus casting out demons. They saw Jesus raising the dead. And they saw Jesus walking on the water. And they saw Jesus calm the storm with just His words. They had a lot of faith in Jesus because they'd seen a lot, they'd experienced a lot. And oh, they loved Him. They had heard the voice of God say, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased." And they were convinced from all that they had experienced that Jesus truly was the Son of God. And He truly was the Savior of the world. All of their faith, all of their hope was in Him. But then one night, in the Garden of Gethsemane, He had gone to pray. They'd gone to sleep. And when they woke up, they found there were soldiers there. Soldiers who bound the hands of Jesus and led Him off captive. Can you imagine the confusion in their minds then? How can mortal man stand against Jesus? We've seen Him defy the elements. We've seen Him cast out demons. We've seen Him do all of these things, and yet He is allowing this to happen. How can somebody with so much power submit to what He's submitting to? As Jesus was led away from them, all of the great expectations that they had for being part of His kingdom had to fade into the darkness too. The giant question marks began to pop up that they never had before. What now? What's next? What are we going to do? What's going to happen with Jesus? You can only imagine. It wasn't long after that they saw Jesus again. But this time when they saw Him, they saw His face that had been beaten to where He no longer looked human. They saw Him having been mocked, cursed, and ridiculed. They saw Him later on beaten with a scourging whip with the flesh ripped from His back. They saw the crown of thorns shoved on His head. They saw the blood running down His face and His face covered in spittle and in blood. Can you imagine how that transformed their thinking? Can you imagine their emotions of what they were going through? Can you imagine what it was like when they watched Jesus nailed to the cross? What were they thinking? How can this be? Well, we had so much faith in Him. He has so much power. We cannot understand why He is hanging on that cross. No doubt they heard Him scream in pain as the nails were driven into His hands, and maybe even every time He took a breath. They probably heard Him whisper in agony. And for 6 long hours, they watched Jesus die. 6 hours. The King of Kings, their Savior, their Messiah, was dying, and they saw it, and they kept waiting for him to suddenly leap off the cross, well, in power and glory, but he didn't do it. And after he took his last breath, they saw that Roman soldier take that spear and shove it into his side, and out flowed the blood in the water. When Jesus died, all their hopes must have died with him. It was over. When they saw his lifeless body being taken down from the cross and placed into the tomb, surely they were at least confused and discouraged and bewildered, like some of us have been with negative things that have happened in our lives recently. Discouraged, yes. Bewildered, yes. Confused, wondering, what now? They were crushed. The Bible says that they were mourning and weeping. We would have been too. Some of you have mourned and you've wept over things that you've experienced in the last couple of months, and you know what that feels like. Maybe that describes your feelings today. Maybe today you're saying, you know what, I'm still confused. I don't understand it. I'm bewildered, I'm discouraged. Oh, what I long for is comfort, and I long for peace in my mind and in my heart. Maybe you're like they were, wondering what bad thing's gonna happen next. We've had one bad thing after another. What's gonna happen next? Another storm? Probably not, according to the weather forecasters. At least not a hurricane, but other bad things do come out of the sky. Is it going to be another virus, or is this one going to get worse, or is it going to go away? Maybe you're wondering, I've lost some loved ones lately. My heart is broken. Am I going to experience the grief over another death? Have you almost reached that breaking point where you feel like giving up? I think the disciples were there. I think they had reached that point. And if you are, take courage. You're not by yourself. There are others feeling the same way. I said we're going to be looking at John chapter 20. If you were going to find it, you'd have found it by now. We're going to look at verse 18. Excuse me. We'll start there if I can keep these pages together. It says that Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, that he had spoken these things unto her. The disciples who had boldly walked with Jesus in faith day after day, I mean, even in the temple where he was hated, they'd boldly walked with him, but now they were hiding. They were huddled together in fear. Can you imagine their conversation? Can you imagine what they were saying to one another with tears in their eyes? Can you imagine they're saying, what's going to happen to us now? What's going to happen to us? They crucified Jesus. Are they going to crucify us next, or they're going to come banging on the door next for us? And then came Mary. She burst into the room saying, I've seen the Lord. I've seen the Lord. He's alive. He's not dead. He's alive. And she told him what he said. He said, I ascend to my Father and to your Father and my God and your God. The disciples didn't believe her. That's just, she's lost her mind. That's impossible. They didn't believe her. But Peter and John said, let's go check. And the Bible says they ran to the cave where he'd been buried, to the tomb. And there they found the grave clothes, just like Mary had said. And they came back. The tomb was empty. The body was gone, just like Mary said. Maybe Mary was right. Maybe Jesus was alive. It was almost too much to hope for. Can you identify with that? A little bit of hope that you say is almost too much to hope for? Somebody's tried to encourage and you say, oh, they can't be right. Maybe you're afraid what's going to happen next. Maybe you're wanting to run and hide like the disciples were doing. They were running and they were hiding because they didn't know what was going to happen. They were afraid for their lives. Maybe you're wanting to run and hide too, but listen to me carefully. If that's what you're feeling in your heart, know this. Mary was right. Jesus was alive, and he still is. Amen, he's still alive. And that changes everything. Absolutely changes it all. That ought to calm our fears. That ought to encourage us. That ought to bring peace of mind where there would be no peace otherwise. Jesus is alive. I want you now to look a little bit farther down to verse 19. It says, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. They were all together and they were hiding out for fear of the Jews. Then came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you. Wow. They'd heard the testimonies. And testimonies are wonderful. We need to hear testimonies of people who have experienced the Lord Jesus in their lives. People like Mary. We need somebody to remind us sometimes of his great divine power, the power even over death. And when we do hear those testimonies, that can encourage discouraged Christians. How many times have you heard in recent weeks, yes, things are bad right now, but the Lord's still on his throne. And when you heard those words, didn't that encourage you just a little bit? Say, you know, you're right. Our country may be going to hell. It may be going to hell in a handbasket. It may be going to hell on purpose, but the Lord's still on his throne. The storms may have destroyed so much, but the Lord's still on his throne. We need to hear those testimonies. And Christians, I want to encourage you, keep sharing them. Keep telling one another. The Lord is alive and he's still on his throne. Don't let people forget about God's power. Don't let people forget about the fact that he doesn't forget us. He still loves us and he won't abandon us. When we hear these reminders, it is so encouraging. Because for just a moment, we get to take our minds and our eyes off the temporal things that are around us that are so negative and put our eyes upon the Lord in heaven. And that's what we need to see. We need to see this is temporary, that's eternal. This is flawed with sin, he is holy. We need to refocus. So when somebody shares those testimonies, it is such a blessing. That's why I want to encourage you not only to listen to the testimonies and gather together and share them one with another, because you're going to bless somebody else when you share the testimony that Jesus is alive. And as great as those testimonies are, as encouraging as those testimonies are, there's something that is more encouraging than that. And it's right in this verse. It says the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. Then came Jesus. Yeah, then came Jesus personally. It wasn't somebody saying, I saw him. Jesus came personally and he stood in their midst. The reality of the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ can conquer every fear. Right now, if Jesus was to suddenly come and sit in your vehicle with you, would anything change? Would your day be changed? How would you feel? Would you be worried about anything? Well, I want to let you know some good news. If you're saved, if you've ever received him as your Savior and Lord, he's not only in your car with you, he's in your heart. He's in you. And he's not going to leave you. And the Bible tells us in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, is greater is he that is within you than he that's within the world. We need to be reminded. Do you believe it? Do you really believe it? I want to hear a horn honk if you believe it. Amen. Now that you've honked your horn saying, I believed it, let me ask you a question. Why are you so afraid? What is it that's got you so frightened? Greater is he that's within you than he that's within the world. Nothing to fear. You know, those disciples were gathered together in fear in that upper room, or the room, wherever they were. And Jesus had said, as I told you in the very beginning when we started the service, that where two or more are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. And you know, it doesn't matter our state of mind when we gather together, whether it's in a building or in a parking lot or any place, Jesus is in our midst. He's here in the parking lot with us. He's here behind me in the building. He's everywhere. We are gathered together. He said He'd be right in our midst. So you say, well, I don't know how He can do that. You don't have to know how. You just got to know He said it. That makes it true. And so when we understand that, we need to just open our spiritual eyes and look around and see Him. And when we see Jesus, I don't mean with our physical eyes, I mean with our spiritual eyes, everything will change. Everything will change. It cannot remain the same. Satan can't stand up against Him. Death can't stand up against Him. Coronavirus can't stand up against Him. The Democrats, the Republicans cannot stand up against Him. Listen, when He is there and you know He is there, you've got nothing to fear. So it's time to shout hallelujah. You may be saying, well, I know that's true. I know that's true. But the truth of the matter is, I've been so focused on the negative stuff, I haven't been able to see Jesus. I've been looking at my torn up house and I can't see Jesus. I haven't been able to find Him. It has captured my attention to the extent that I haven't been able to see Him. Open your spiritual eyes. Look, Jesus is alive. He's right there with you. And you can experience His presence. You can hear His voice if you'll just listen to Him. Say, Jesus, I need to hear from You. Jesus, speak to my heart. Jesus, encourage me. He did to the disciples. You look at that 19th verse. What did He say to them? Peace be unto you. They needed some peace. They were afraid for their very lives. They needed some peace. He said, peace be unto you. He didn't say, I hope you get better. He didn't say, I hope you're encouraged. Don't be so afraid. No, He said, peace be unto you. Listen, this is as great a commandment as when He said, let there be light. There was light. Are you listening? He can bring peace by the very power of who He is. Bringing peace into your life and into mine. Peace be unto you. He knew what those disciples needed. So He provided it. He said, peace be unto you. And they got it. Because they left that upper room. They were not afraid anymore. They were not terrified. They were not hiding anymore. They went out to do what He sent them out to do. Boldly proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ wherever they went, no matter what it cost them. They were transformed by the supernatural power and the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ. He gave it to them. He knows what we need too. He knows that we need peace of mind in our own lives. He knows that we need peace in our home. He knows that we need peace in our nation. He said, oh, can He really provide that peace? Isaiah 9:6 says He's the Prince of Peace. Yeah, He's the ruler. He's the controller. He's the Prince of Peace. And He can bring the peace that passes all understanding, no matter what our circumstances might be. No matter what might be troubling us. He can bring us that peace that we so desperately need. We just got to look up and listen to Him. Well, maybe you're like those discouraged disciples thinking, all right, I know Jesus is alive. I know He is. I've read the scriptures. I've believed Him for years. I believe that He did rise from the grave. I believe He's alive, but where is He? Where is He? I need Him here with me now. Where is Jesus? I'm not experiencing His presence, but I want to. If you really want to, I got news for you. You can. You can experience His presence. Oh, but you got to start in the right place. You got to see. These were disciples. These were not folks off the streets that were non-believers. These were not unconverted Jews. These were the ones who had trusted Him as their Lord and Savior. And if you can become one of His disciples, you will experience His presence. You will. When you confess your sins and repent of them, and you invite Jesus Christ into your heart and your life, He will move in and He will change some things. He will make His presence known in your life. The Bible says you'll be born again. You'll become a new creation, a whole new creature. Old things are going to pass away. All things are going to become new. Yes, you can experience the presence of Jesus in your life. But you start by trusting Him as your Lord and your Savior. If you've never done that, I pray you will not leave this parking lot until you do. Why would you leave here without Jesus when you can have Him? Why would you go on in fear and trouble and confusion and worry when you don't have to, when you can have the peace that passes all understanding? If there's any doubt in your mind about Jesus living in your heart and in your life, I'm going to give you a moment to pray in just a moment. And I'm going to give you a chance and encourage you to pray and trust Him as your Savior and Lord. And if you're already saved, I'm going to give you a chance to say, reach out to Jesus and say, forgive me for not trusting you more. Forgive me for ignoring who you are in my life. I want to know that you love me. I want to share one more thing with you. Can you experience Jesus? I mean the reality of His presence? And the answer is, oh yes, in a way that we cannot even comprehend. And that is, Jesus is coming soon. I mean, He's really coming. He's going to come back to this planet and everything's going to change when He does. I'm one of those who believe that He's going to come for the church and rapture all the believers off of this planet. Maybe now, before noon. But then after that, He's going to come and take over. He's going to come and conquer every bit of evil on this world. He's first going to rescue us away from the evil, and then He's going to come back and deal with it. Oh, listen, if you're one of His disciples, you can cheer up because He's going to come to rescue you. It doesn't matter how bad things are going to get in this sin-saturated world that troubles us. Whenever He comes, if you belong to Him, whatever you're fearing right now will disappear forever. All right now, you can trust Him and experience His presence and power, and you may be delivered from those fears. And tomorrow you may have a whole new set of fears, or they may be back again, but you do the same thing. You just go back to Jesus. Say, Jesus, here I am. I need you. I need your peace today. I need your presence. Your presence that brings that peace. And that's what I need. How do you fit into this picture this morning? Can you see yourself like the disciples, discouraged? Everything might have been going great for a while and then it got terrible. Do you need Jesus? If you want to trust Him as your Savior and your Lord, I'm going to give you a chance to pray and I'm going to ask you to do this. After you have prayed and you've asked Jesus to come into your heart and life, I'm going to ask you just to blink your headlights at me so I can see you. All right? But if you're saved and you haven't been living for the Lord, you have not been experiencing His presence and His power in your life, and it's because you just haven't been focused on Him, you haven't been praying like you should or whatever, we're going to give you a chance to repent of that too. So let's do that right now. Let's bow our heads and pray together. Heavenly Father, we do bow before You now. We thank You, Lord, for Your wonderful power. We thank You for Your great love, and we thank You for Jesus. Lord, we know that He changes everything. Father, if there's even one person here that's not sure they're saved, let them know the reality. Let them know that they need to trust Your Son and be born again right now. Help them to repent of their sins, dear Father, and ask Jesus to come into their hearts. He said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone will hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him." Father, we take Him at His word. So if somebody's here that's never opened the door and invited Jesus in, I pray they will right now. And Father, give them the faith to do that. And then give them the courage in a moment to flash their headlights so we might see and rejoice and we might help them in a new life with Christ instead of living the life that they've been living without Him. And Father, I pray for others that have been discouraged, others that have needed an encouraging word today, and I pray they've gotten it. May we trust You more. May we rejoice in Your presence. And Father, may we share the testimony that the world needs to hear. Jesus is alive. It's in His name we pray. Amen. Amen.